Our scripture this morning comes from that wonderful book of Psalms named Psalms, chapter 37, verses 1 through 9. Miss Arma's going to read those to us. Listen carefully to the words that she's going to share with us that King David wrote to us in the most beautiful way, knowing the wonders of what God has done for us and what He will continue to do for us as we make this journey through life.
Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land, enjoy safe pasture. That delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him, and He will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. Your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret with people. Succeed in their ways. When they carry out their wicked schemes, refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, and those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Kevin, if you will give us the next slide, I want to take a minute for y'all to reminisce just a little bit. Many of you, this will strike a chord. There was a word that she used in one of the very first few words of verse 1, and that word was fret. I always thought fret was something that I did when my mother knew that I did something wrong before I got home. That was fretting. But what King David wanted us to understand this word to mean today is when you strike a match. You know how that match will kind of explode in the beginning, and it will ignite itself into a big flame, and then it will burn itself down as the sulfur burns away. What King David wanted us to understand is when that flame ignites, that's the hottest time of that fire. I think the point that King David wanted us to make is a warning. It's a warning. He says not to fret ourselves or burst into a flame of emotion because of those who do evil. You know, it's awful hard to do that. It's awful hard for us to keep our calm sometimes because most of us have seen how unfair life can actually be. It always seems that those people who prosper the most are those ones that are the furthest away from God or may even hate God the most. Why does God allow wicked people to prosper while the righteous people have to suffer through life?
Our suffering is to humble us.
Suffering can be to humble us, for sure.
The reward.
And I wish that I could more fully answer that question, but I'm in good company, I guess, because even though I would like to give y'all some great theological answer why that's always the case, But I feel in good company because King Solomon, King David's son Solomon, he couldn't answer that question either. And the Bible gives us a hint that he was probably one of the wisest of the wise. But I think that what King David wants us to know is that God is the one that's in charge of business. God is the one that's saying what goes on. God is the one that's in control. Our responsibility, though, is not really to try to figure it out. But our responsibility is to accept God for who he is and to trust that he is going to do what he is doing and he is going to make it all right. But how can we have any hope if the wicked always seem to prosper while the righteous always suffer? Well, I think if you look at verse 2, we'll get some of that answer. Verse 2 tells us, "For they shall be cut down like the grass, and they shall wither as the herb." Remember, God's word is final. If God says that one day the wicked are going to be cut down, they're going to be cast down, then rest assured, my friends, that is what's going to happen. God will deal with them, though, in a way that we could never imagine. But I also know this in my heart, that God's going to deal with them in a way that is both righteous and is both holy. Now, we need to stop fretting over the prosperity of the wicked, and we need to look forward to what God has in store for us, those of us who are called his children. The remainder of Psalms 37 will show us how to overcome being envious of the wicked by looking forward to the promise that God has made for us. God has made promises for those of us who call ourselves his children, but something is also required of us before we can claim those promises. Psalms 37:3 gives us a hint of how that happens, because it tells us to trust in the Lord and do good, so thou shalt dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. We have a responsibility, my friends, to trust in God. Trust is a characteristic, really Old Testament word, but it is a testament, if you will, for the New Testament's word for faith and belief. Just, you know how I am sometimes with statistics. The word trust appears 152 times in the Old Testament. It tells us that we need to signify taking refuge. We need to lean on God. We need to trust in God. I think the basic ideal of that word trust is associated with firmness, is associated with solidity, the ground that we stand on. I think it means to put faith and to believe in Jesus Christ, because he will protect us, he will keep us, he will hold us in his wonderful arms in times of trouble. He will be there to lean on when our bodies and our spirits get weak. He will be there just like a firm and solid rock. He is always going to never be moved. The all-important step, I think, to trusting God is having faith, is believing in him. It would be awful hard to trust in God if you didn't believe in him first. There has to be a personal relationship between each of us and God. That relationship can only take place, though, through that knowledge of the gospel message. We hear that word gospel message a lot. What is the gospel message? Well, I can think of a whole bunch of pages in that book that God has given to us, but there's one in particular that I want to bring up today, and it comes from 1 Corinthians 15. And that gospel message I want us to understand relative to what we're talking about today is for I have delivered unto you first of all that which I also have received, how Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he was buried, and he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures. The gospel message, my friend, is that Jesus Christ died for our sins. He was buried and he rose again on the third day. And when we accept, and by accepting that message and turning toward him, repenting from our sinful ways, then we can have that personal relationship that we need with God, that relationship of that man who created all of this universe in which we live. By accepting Jesus Christ as our Savior, we placed our trust in God. And by placing our trust in God, we regain access to the many promises that are given to us throughout the Bible. The one in Psalms 37:3 that Miss Irma read to us, "So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed." Let's tie that verse together with another verse that's really well known to all of us. It comes from Proverbs. And that verse tells us, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on our own understanding. In all ways acknowledge him, and he will direct our path." If we trust in the Lord, if we take refuge in the Lord, if we lean on him, if we stand upon his solid attributes, then God himself will give us the strength and the guidance that we need to go forward in this very wicked world in which we live in. Not only will he direct our paths, but he gives us the assurance that as he is doing so, he will make sure that we get fed along the way. Isn't God good? Isn't he good? Have you placed your trust in God? Have you turned from all of your sinful ways? These are questions I had to ask myself as I was preparing for today.
We're always a work in progress until we're ready.
We are always on the journey towards salvation. I asked myself, Gary, are you confident that Jesus Christ lived as a human? Gary, are you confident that Jesus Christ died and he was buried and he rose again on the third day? And I had to ask myself, are you sure? Are you sure? Because I know that if I'm not sure, on that day, I will be among those poor souls that God is going to take vengeance upon. Verse 4 tells us, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart." What does it mean to delight in the Lord? I think it means to take pleasure in him, to enjoy him. That sounds a little strange, I think. I mean, to enjoy God.
But why should it
sound strange to us? I'm sure that this morning when we got up and we opened our eyes to see this magnificent sunshine outside, to see the beauty of the leaves beginning to fall from the trees, I was overwhelmed when I saw this myself this morning at the splendor that God provides for us every day. That, my friends, is enjoying God. God created this earth. God created everything in this earth, including us, and he allows us to live here and to be able to enjoy it. If we could contemplate everything that God has given us through our lives and we sought to enjoy all of it, we would be overwhelmed. I told someone of a scripture last week, and I think it kind of fits my point here, and that scripture comes from the book of Job. Well, I'm going through the Bible today, aren't I? But that verse says, "Hearken unto this, O Job. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God." Kevin's going to put this on the screen in just a minute, and I want you to fill in the blank. as you read it to yourself. For me, it says, hearken unto this, Gary. Stand still and consider the wondrous works of God. Have you taken the time out of your busy day to think about what really God has blessed us with? When was the last time that we actually sit down and consider those wondrous works that God has given to us? I believe that if we would slow down and think a little bit more about what God has given to us, rather than thinking about what has kept us so busy, those things may not seem so important anymore. Why should we delight in God's creation and His blessings upon us? Why should we? Because we should. Just because. Most of us should delight in the salvation that has been afforded to us by the death and the resurrection and the hope of eternal life and salvation by Jesus Christ. If we delight in what He has given to us, then He gives us an interesting promise. And that promise we read in that verse, He shall give us the desires of our hearts. What a wonderful promise that is. Does that mean that God is going to give Gary everything he wants?
No.
But it does mean that God is going to give us everything that we need if we delight in Him. I believe that God gives us desires. But I also believe that before He gives us those desires, that if we read His words of wisdom, if we pray to Him, if we study Him, then we will be able to understand what His desires are for us. And as we continue that process, then those desires will become what our desires are in life as well. He gives us desires of our hearts when they line up with His desire for our life. In verse 5, we read, commit unto the Lord, trust in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. And He shall bring forth the righteousness as the light, and the judgment as by noonday. We find a couple of things interesting, I think, here. A definition given by the Hebrew lexicon is this. Is to be rolled in blood or to be dyed red. Psalms 37 really is no messianic psalms, but it's a prophecy. It's a beautiful prophecy. And it's a prophecy that allows us to commit to the Lord. And if we do so, then we must be rolled in that blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us that day on the cross. That's exactly what that old hymn by William Cowper that we sung earlier said. Fountain filled with blood, drawn from mangled veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood, lose all of their guilty stains. What a wonderful promise that is. I think the point of this particular verse is that we will be judged at noonday, the brightest time of the day for all of us is righteous. And God's judgment upon us will be brought out in the open underneath the brightest time and for everyone to see. If we've committed to Him, if we've been rolled in the blood of the Lamb, and we've been made righteous by that action, we don't have to rely anymore on our own ability to be righteous. We take on the righteousness of Jesus Christ Himself, and we become clothed in that righteousness. That's a promise that God has made to us. It also tells us to rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Fret not because of him who prospereth in his way, because the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. He tells us to cease from anger forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait upon the Lord shall inherit the earth. What a beautiful promise. We're told to do a number of things in these verses that were read to us. Resting in the Lord, that's a phrase we hear a lot. It's accomplished, though, I think, by a few things. It's accomplished by us trusting, us delighting, and us committing ourselves to God. If we have first accomplished those three things, then resting in Him is easy. When we trust in God, we find rest because God becomes our place of refuge. He becomes our place of safety, especially in times of trouble. We can find rest because we have found a shelter that we can lean on when our bodies and when our spirits, we found a shoulder that we can cry on when our bodies and our spirits have become weak. We can rest because God is there to stand when that ground underneath us begins to give away. When we delight in the Lord, we find rest because God blesses us with the desires of our hearts. We can rest because our thoughts have become more in line with what His thoughts are. We can rest because we're looking through His eyes, and when we do, everything becomes much more clear. When we commit to God, we find rest because we know that we no longer have to worry about the sin that's in our lives or in our world. We can rest easy knowing that we're clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. We're always told when we read the Bible to wait on the Lord. To wait on the Lord. My friends, I'm as guilty as anyone wanting to hurry up. Hurry up. But my friends, we should never try to hurry God up, or try to force God to give His will to us the way we want it. We always must be patient. We always must be trusting. And when we trust Him to accomplish, then He will do it with us in His time. The Bible tells us to cease from anger and forsake wrath. God wants us, He does not want us to go around half-cocked waiting to explode when that first person looks at us wrong. I had to take this to heart this week. If we're resting in Him, then we should be able to control our temper. Miss Pearl Cameron, my fifth grade Spanish teacher, sentence she used to use a lot. I never understood it until today, until this week. She'd say, "Gary, don't lose your temper. You find it. Don't lose your temper. Find it." What a true statement that is. Turn your back on anger. We also are told, do not wish to do evil, to stay pure before the Lord. We have God's promise that those who wait upon the Lord, we will inherit the earth. All the things that we're told to do in this passage of Scripture are condensed, I think, to just a couple of things. And Kevin's going to give those to us on the monitor. The first thing we have to do is we have to trust in the Lord, and He will give us strength to go forward. We have to delight in the Lord, and He will give us the desires of our hearts. We will commit to the Lord, and He will clothe us in His righteousness, and we will rest in the Lord, and we will ultimately inherit the earth. Pray with me. Father, accept our thanks and our praise for all that You've done for us. We thank You for the splendor of the whole creation, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you, Father, for our successes which satisfy and delight us, but also for our disappointments and our failures to acknowledge us and lead us to the knowledge that we have to depend on you. Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life. We thank you for his dying through which we overcame death and for his rising to life again, in which we're raised in the life of your kingdom. Father, may we at all times, and may we in all places, give thanks to you in all things. We say these in your wonderful and precious name. Amen. I ask you this morning to join with me in a liturgy. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Christ our Lord this morning invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sins and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let all of us confess our sin before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, this morning, though, I want you to hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
We lift them up to the Lord.
It is right and good. It is right and good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you. Father, almighty creator of heaven and earth, you formed us in your image and you breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join in the unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who were oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. You healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and your Holy Spirit. My friends, on that night in which he gave himself up for us, He took bread. He gave thanks to you, and he broke that bread. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Here, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, and always do it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out the Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world until Christ comes. In that wonderful final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence as children of God, pray with me. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we remember this Last Supper, there is just one loaf. We who are many are one body in Christ. The bread which we break is a sharing of the body of Christ. The cup that we drink from is giving thanks and sharing in the blood of Jesus Christ. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we do this morning in remembrance, as commanded by Jesus. Take just a few minutes and thank him for his sacrifice and for his goodness.
Thank you.
us as your children. As we leave today, we go forth into the parish of our world. Help us to be the walk that you want us to be. Help us to be the talk that you want us to be. Guide us, protect us, love us, keep us. Father, thank you for your blessings. In your name this morning we pray, and all of God's children said,
Amen. Amen.
Have a great, wonderful, and glorious day. Remember, you have God's favor.